on the Cooligans in the first segment. Nani joins Orlando. Me, I join Orlando City because I am Nani. That's what everybody needs to know. Also, we talk about the future of U.S. soccer, the future of the Confederations Cup, the Gold Cup, a 58-team playoff. I don't know. Who knows anymore? But and also, more Jonathan Lewis love slash hate, and we try to figure out what's going on with him.
Yeah, in the second segment, we talk to Cal Martino. That's right. He spills all the tea on what happened during the campaign. He talks about all that real stuff. We have a great conversation with him at the United Soccer Coaches Conference, and we're finally putting that out. So we got that and more on this episode of the Cooligans!
Hey, this is Alexi Lalas. There is nobody in U.S. soccer that is more important than the Cooligans.
Yeah, baby!
Good.
Yeah.
Hello. Welcome, everybody. I hope you had a lovely President's Day.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a very important holiday. I hope maybe you bought a new Volvo. Who
Air
knows?
Air quotes. You know?
Because every president is great. Every single one.
No one has ever done anything bad.
We got to celebrate each and every one equally because they're all so good. You know, maybe some blemishes occasionally with a little bit of slavery here, slavery there.
Yeah. But a couple dings in the armor, you know?
But you know what?
Some of them are so bad they wouldn't have said dings. You know, they would have went the other way.
No, you know, that was so long ago. Who knows? Nobody even remembers any of that stuff.
President. Day.
Welcome to your favorite soccer podcast, everybody. Hello, we are the Cooligans.
Yeah, baby.
My name is Christian Polanco.
Yeah, my name is Alexis Guerreros.
We are your favorite stand-up comedians out in New York City at the top of Madison Square Garden.
The tip of the top.
That hosts the funniest soccer podcast that you have ever listened to.
Mm-hmm, but it ain't just that.
Not that exclusively.
Nah.
What else is it, Alexis?
It's a couple other things, but right after to being the funniest, and some would say right adjacent to it, we just so happen to be the gulliest soccer podcast.
Right. So, yes, this is the realest soccer podcast.
It's the trillest. We're the trillest
soccer podcast that you're going to listen to.
I can hear our white fans frantically Googling what trill means.
You can hear the white fans asking to speak to their manager.
Yeah. I can hear them wondering right now, am I allowed to say trillist?
Welcome, everybody. Yes,
what's up?
We're back in studio because I was not here last week. I was abroad in
Hey, have some respect for the you were that's right, you were. Actually, you weren't abroad.
I was transitioning,
domestic.
Okay? I was abroad for a week.
You were domestic. That's not abroad.
Abroad from the
Republic of New York.
Once I leave this zip code, all right, I don't understand how anything works out here. What are these foods you guys are eating?
The República Dominicana de Nueva York is where Christian lives.
That's right. No, I was in Colorado. Great time. I had an absolute blast.
It's hard to not have a good time in Colorado. They've pretty much legalized fun.
Yes. Yes. And I did partake in the fun a little bit.
Do you want to go skiing? Well, do it completely impaired, bro. Also, there's a chips at the bottom of the hill. What?
Yeah, man.
Oh, man. I got to get there.
No, the snowboarding was great. Vail was great. I was talking about it a little bit last week, but Denver, when I spoke to you, I was in Vail, but I went to Denver, and Denver was so fun.
But then
fun.
You got deported because you're brown out of Vail. And then you
sure. Yeah. I mean, look, those are the rules.
You got to follow the rules.
They said it was a national emergency. Once I got to Vail, Trump was like, we got to get him out of here.
Right. The People's Republic of Vail were like, we can't have it. We just can't have it.
So, but Denver was really, really fun. And I'm glad while I was in Denver, whenever I got an opportunity to speak to someone about the Colorado Rapids or just MLS in general, first, they didn't know what I was talking about.
Of course not. I was going to say, did anyone know what you were talking about? They're like, he's speaking in tongues this
one. Some people knew. Some people had been like, I've never been to a game. But when I was getting the rental car, the guy that was helping with the car, he was like, I was wearing an NYCFC hat, and he was like, is that New York Red Bulls? I'm like, what? I'm like,
it's blue and a different logo.
I'm like, wow, what a, I mean, you were fairly close, I guess, but I feel like you should have not said that. Like,
yeah, maybe, how'd you figure that out, buddy?
So
how did you put 2 and 17 together?
But I told him, I was like, hey, you should go to a Colorado Rapids game. He's like, no, I've never been. And he was just like, no, man, I've never been to one.
What? You drive.
but then he was like, my son has been to a game, but I've never been. So I'm like, all right, well.
He's like, we disowned him.
I'm like, what? Dude, I'm like, okay, do you know who your son is? Dude, where is your son right now?
do you know who your son is? That's perfect.
But he was like, you know what? I think
just
I'm
just playing James Taylor the whole time.
He was like, oh, I think I might actually go to a game. I was like, we had a conversation about it and stuff like that. Told him about MLS a little bit, Cooligans and everything. And
that's pretty dope.
So I did my job, everybody. I think I'm doing better than the other Colorado Rapids fans getting people to Colorado Rapids games.
Yeah. I mean, you're doing special work.
So that was fun. How was your week without me?
Lonely.
Okay.
I only got to talk to you on the phone. It was weird. I kept putting my hand up against the window. Put my hand up against the rain. It was fun. Just doing stand up, trying to do as much, doing all these auditions now that it's a pilot season.
That's right.
Not getting anything, which is pretty dope.
I went for, there was about 3 years I was auditioning for commercials. I remember I booked the second commercial I auditioned for,
which just set you up for sadness.
Like, that is it. I'm gonna be.
So now I just start getting all of them.
Yeah. Okay. Where's my Super Bowl ad?
Yeah.
And then audition after audition, and nothing, not a callback.
Yeah.
A couple callbacks here and there, but yeah, it was rough.
I've gotten a few callbacks. One of them was pretty cool. But yeah, nonetheless, whatever, just doing my own thing.
You did a show just recently for, I wish you would have mentioned it last week, but the Cuba.
Oh, that's right. We did a show. It was sold out. So,
okay.
Yeah, which is pretty cool. Yeah, we did a show to benefit. We saved Cuba.
You saved Cuba.
I saved Cuba, guys. And I didn't have to kill a Castro. I want everyone to know I will. You just let me know.
You would. You will or you would?
No.
I mean, you really
oh, no.
Just.
It's in my plans. I put it in my calendar.
I think it's premeditated at this point.
Yeah. I put it in my calendar. I will. I'm not going to tell you the day, but I will.
You know, it'll be a surprise for everybody.
No, I would. Remember that Scarface when he's like, is he a communist? I kill a communist for fun. Yeah, remember he said that when they were all in there? That's how I feel about a catcher. Anyway, there's a group called, I forget the name of the group. Oh, Caritas Cuba.
Okay.
And they're sending money to all the people that were decimated during the hurricane there. Only 6 people died. It wasn't like, like a Maria level. But if you've ever seen photos of what the infrastructure in Cuba is like, hard of a rainfall and there's buildings collapsing.
It looks like there's a hurricane every week.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
It's bad.
You're like, so was there a bombing here recently? And they're like, nope, that's how the buildings look since 1987. So we did a fundraiser. It was cool. All Cuban comics.
Okay.
Some of them were only a quarter Cuban. But
why did you have to point that out?
We cobbled them together.
Were you mad at them?
Because one of them is Mike Brown.
Oh, Mike Brown is a quarter.
His grandmother's Cuban.
All right, that's great. Yeah. All right, that changes everything. Now I like him.
That's literally what I said to him. I go, this is why I like you, my guy. But so it was cool. It was cool to see just people coming together to save Cuba. I came out. I made a Puerto Rican flag joke. It crushed, and I was like, "These are my people." Finally, I feel like I'm at Thanksgiving.
That's it. We had a show where all the audience was Cuban MLS fans. Well, that's it.
Oh my god!
You would just be in your wheelhouse.
Oh, me and those 4 people would just be enjoying ourselves. Me and Ozzy Alonso's family would be having the best time.
Every time you're like Monica would be, "Se murió Fidel," after every punchline.
Even if it doesn't hit, I'd be like, and then the cupcake. No laughter. I'm like, somebody go for that. And they're like, that's my hamburger.
Yeah, hamburger.
somebody took, if you guys don't know what hamburger is, a comic who wore like a suit and almost kind of like a cowboy hat. It was like a blend between a fedora and a cowboy hat.
It was like a 10-gallon hat.
Yeah. And he would, black dude, and he would sometimes have a newspaper in his hand, and he'd smack it up against his leg. At the end of every punchline, he would just go, hamburger. And that was it.
And that was it.
Still a funny comic, but he would have this stupid thing. So now he's kind of like him and Shuggy Duck and Quack Quack. Those are the two that are my favorite.
Sure.
If you don't know what I'm talking about, Google Shucky, Ducky, Quack, and you will be amazed.
Yeah, hopefully we can shed light on these important comedic figures.
These icons. But somebody took, remember Trump tweeted Hamburger?
Yes.
Somebody took an old set of his and replaced Hamburger with Hamburger. It was so stupid.
So I'm glad. All right. So that I'm glad that went well. Speaking of when I was in Colorado doing stand up in Denver, I got to bump into Travis Irvine.
Yeah, I saw Columbus Crew.
Columbus Crew.
Did he thank you for being half of the people that saved the crew?
He did not. And that was my first bone to pick with
him. Bone to pick with you, buddy.
I don't know. I don't think you understand exactly how much of 100% influence I had on saving the crew.
Yeah. You think the Haslams would have bought that team if it wasn't for the sparsely attended show we did in Columbus? got some balls if that's what you think.
But I did get to talk to him, and it was cool to, he was hilarious, by the way. And as you know, Travis Irvine is a
very funny comic.
A very funny comic, Columbus Crew fan. He's been a former guest of the Cooligans. He's been on the show. And it was nice to see him so happy and you know, excited about his team coming back. So I'm glad I got to see him. So a couple other things.
Oh, wait, while you were gone, whatchamacallit, Bobby Warshaw came into one of my shows.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, Bobby Warshaw came out. He hung out.
Look at that. The MLS doing some recon.
All right.
They got to send them out. Like, let's see what these guys are up to.
They send the spies out, you know? And it was cool. He wasn't loud or abrasive or anything. People were like, did he heckle? He seems like the kind of person who would heckle, but he did not.
No, Bobby Warshaw is a good guy.
It was a New York Comedy Club show, and I was headlining, which was kind of cool.
Okay.
Great show. He came up, he gave me some compliments, and as he was talking to me, a whole family came out, and they're like, hey, I want to take a picture with you. And then it was like one of those where it's like, let's just do a group.
Yeah, well, Bobby, hold on a second. I gotta
Bobby,
talk
I'm
to...
I'm sorry, my fan. You remember what this was like, right?
I gotta go inspire these people.
But like, one person would take a picture with like me and the two, like the mom and the aunt, and then the daughter's like, I want to take a picture. So then I had to take a picture with the kids, and then like the dad's like, you know what, I want a picture too. I'm like, all right, this is now... And they can't figure out how to make their Android work, so I'm just getting the flashlight in my eye for like 10 seconds. And I got to host the next show, so I was like, guys, I got to go.
Yeah, yeah.
So I talked to Bobby for like 10 minutes. He's like, me and my friends are going to get beer. You want some? I'm like, I wish I could. I gotta stay here. So I didn't get a chance to hang out with him afterwards, but it was pretty cool.
All right. Well, thank you, Bobby Warshaw, for supporting live comedy.
Yeah, and he tweeted it out. You know, maybe they're talking about it in the front office, and they're like, yo, instead of having him do stuff for us, maybe we should just send the Cooligans a lot of money.
That's what Bobby was there for.
You think
he's
that
really
came up?
Just there to confirming. Yeah. He's there to confirm how much money we're going to give the Cooligans.
Double it.
I just saw a set.
Yeah. He's got this great bit about his wife being a nurse. Double it.
So thank you for that. All right. And for people listening, if we are doing stand up in your city, this is your opportunity. Be like Bobby Warshaw and come out to see a show.
That's what you should do, is always think to yourself, what would
Bobby Warshaw do? After he, slide tackles, two-footed challenges you, what would he do after that? He'd probably go to your comedy show. Uh-huh,
and he belittles your thought. Get out there.
Okay? He'll explain to you why he would be better at your job.
Yeah, that he's going to do. He does it to Matt Doyle, okay? If he does it to him, he's going to do it to you.
So, usually the way we begin this show is by...
15 minutes later.
By showing love to the people who show us love on iTunes. We are so close to our 400th review on iTunes. We are 385. So you want to be number 400? Help out. Help us get there. And this week we've had a couple tremendous reviews that they're too long to read.
Yeah, one of them in particular is just a little too long to read, but it's very nice.
I recommend people looking at our iTunes review. This one I want to read.
This one, the long one was left on Valentine's Day. Did you notice that?
I did notice that, and thank you for the love. Of all days to leave that. So
there's Mighty Duck references in there. He talks about his pre-Cooligans era and the anal Cooligan era. It's an epic review.
The anal Cooligans era is very different.
It's, like I said, not only will a Castro die, the anal Cooligans era is coming. I will. I'm going to get
mine. It's been a little uncomfortable, I got to say, that era.
Sliding in and out of it has been Very difficult.
Okay, so, but shout out.
Some would say it stinks. Am I right, everybody? All right.
From Megadave33. So I'm just going to read the subject.
This is the one I'm talking about.
Yeah. So Dave has been a fairly long time Cooligans fan, if I remember correctly. But the subject just says, like waffles and marmalade. So is that good? I assume that's good.
I think it's a song reference. I don't know. But I do know that the last two sentences are by far the funniest.
Oh, you want to read them?
Yeah. The same way Eddie Money brought us two tickets to paradise, the Cooligans can quell the tantrum of a toddler who just dropped a chocolate popsicle in their lap while wearing white shorts. Truly, this is heaven.
Thank you,
Dave. So if you want to know what any of that means, you got to read chapters 1 through 19.
It is a soliloquy. Yeah. I mean, there's no. It's beautiful. And it's just too long to read, but it's incredible. And thank you so much for that review. The other review I wanted to read was from George B. And this was on February 16th. And the subject says, caught myself saying my guy to a sixth grader. So this has been happening a little bit. We have a surprising amount of teachers who listen to this show and are somewhat influenced in their language and how they speak to their children. It seems like we're helping them connect to these kids who probably do not say my guy and all of a sudden are starting to say my guy.
Yeah. We're influencing the youth. This is a positive thing, regardless of what school psychologists tell you. This is a positive thing.
So I wanted to read one particular line because this is also a very long review. This is from a guy in Los Angeles. He says Chicano several times, and I'm assuming he's Mexican. I'm sure this dude is awesome, George B. But one thing he did mention that I absolutely loved and I was totally flattered by. He goes, I remember when people started paying more attention to the Daily Show for news rather than actual journalists. This is what the Cooligans are doing for soccer.
Yeah.
This is, so George B.
We're going to steal that. And next time we talk to an agent, that's what we're saying.
So I don't know if you know that. I don't know if I've mentioned this on the show before, but Daily Show is one of my favorite shows. I've been watching it for years with Jon Stewart, with Trevor Noah, you know, that format style show is I've submitted for shows like that. I want to write for them and things like that. Yeah. So that's sort of the vision we've always had with Cooligans. We're like,
without being explicitly trying to be like that.
Yeah.
It's like, imagine the way they were like, you think people want to hear the news and comedy at the same time is probably the same thing we were going through in the beginning. We're like, you think they want to do soccer and comedy? So like, the fact that that's a reference that's pulled is perfect.
Yeah, that's incredibly flattering. Thank you so much for saying that, because that's very much on our minds. And it has become this thing where we've become more... when we first started this podcast, we just knew very like casually about American soccer.
Yeah.
And now we're like deep in it. All right. We're just
the deep state.
We're deep state. Yeah. We're covered in the filth of American soccer.
Oh, yeah. We're up to our necks in Tamingham.
So we feel like from a the perspective of how knowledgeable we are about it,
right,
has definitely, I feel that way. I'm like, this is crazy. I didn't expect to know all this stuff. I got all this damn stuff in my head about soccer.
We got all this stupid knowledge in our head that we didn't think we were going to have.
Yeah. So that's incredibly flattering. So thank you so much for mentioning that.
I want to read this one. This is from WoW1121. One My Staple podcast. I'm assuming he means one of my staple podcasts.
Sure.
5 stars, which is always, that's what you do. We're not going to read it if you give us 4. Let me get out of town. All right. I have never heard of the Cooligans really until they came to my, oh wait, this is the wrong one.
No, that was great. I like that one.
Yeah, I didn't want to read that one though. I want to, getting into the classroom, my guy. Well, shouts to WoW1121. We'll try to go back to Virginia Beach. But anyway, so this is from Staves49. Getting into the classroom, my guy, 5 stars. As a 7th grade teacher, I constantly try to get my students to get into the beautiful game, and these guys are the perfect gateway drug pod. I push the gulliest pod in my classroom, and I know it's working because now my students walk into my class and greet me with a good morning, my guy. Keep up the good work, gents.
That's
we will, my guy.
That's beautiful. Thank you.
Yo, shouts to your grade.
Yo, 7th grade, 6th graders, everybody.
What do we call it, Mr. S? Or wait, no, teachers go by first names now, right? Did you hear about this?
I mean, that's not everywhere, but maybe it's some weird charter school.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They were like, hey, man, we're cool.
Call me by my middle name. Yeah. You know?
Welcome to Hacky Sack 101.
Yeah, so thank you for
that. The school lunch today is quinoa and prayer. But anyway, Staves 49. What's up, my guy?
Yeah, that's good.
And shouts to the students, yo.
So thank you for that. So today, packed, yo. We're going to talk
about... Yo, if the kids are listening right now, you got half a day. Yeah. How about that, yo? Just walk out. You want to be gully?
Yo, Staves is cool about it.
Yo, Staves is totally chill about it. He definitely won't lose his job.
So a bunch of things going on. Obviously, CONCACAF Champions League kicking off tonight, where we're recording this on Tuesday. Happening tonight. There'll be a games today as you're listening to this. We'll talk about that. Kyle Martino's on the show.
Oh, yeah.
From the United Soccer Coaches Convention. We'll play that interview, which was dope. And we had a really, the second time Kyle Martino's on the show.
First time in person.
Exactly. We got to touch his hair.
Yeah, because he curved us the last time, yo.
Oh, yeah. I don't think people know about that.
I don't think
that.
We talked about it. Yeah, he was supposed to be physically on the show.
This is when he was campaigning for U.S. soccer
president. Yeah, and we were like, he should be here any minute, right? Because he said he would be here at, whatever, 2 o'clock.
Yeah.
And then we get a call from, or a message from his, manager or handler or whoever
it was like his campaign manager.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Like that.
And he was like, all right, so we're going to do a call in because he's not in New York. We're like, when were you going to tell us that?
Yeah, it's like when you're running 5 minutes late, but you get there 30 minutes late.
Yeah.
But this is like, yeah, I'm running 5 minutes late, but like, I'm not even in the state.
I'm not going. Do me a favor. Just FaceTime with me into this party so I can congratulate my cousin and I'll go back to doing what I was doing.
That's what Martino hit us with. But the interview over the phone was great. But I think for a podcast like this, which is a comedy podcast,
yeah,
it's a little tougher. That's why we've been trying to have more in-person interviews,
right,
than over the phone, because the comedic timing is a little bit lost when it's over the phone. Depending on who it is, some people can, they can cry. Ray Hudson just can crush it.
He couldn't even hear us.
He could barely hear us.
There was an issue with the studio that day. He could barely hear us.
And he was just crushing it. Yeah, exactly. So a lot to talk about, but let's start with, where should we start with? Not Champions. Let's start with the news about the Confederations Cup.
Okay.
The Confederations Cup, if you recall, it is the tournament the year before the World Cup.
It kind of feels almost like a World Cup warm-up.
Yes.
Remember Mexico was out in Russia?
Yes.
Yeah.
So this was, who won it? Germany won it. The last Confederations Cup.
And you saw how integral that was for them to succeed during the World Cup.
Good thing they kept that sweet form. All the way into...
It propelled them. They brought that with them.
So the Confederations Cup, which has been going on, I believe, since 2005, is the tournament of, every country that wins their confederation plays in, an 8-team tournament. Right. It's sort of a phony toner. Nobody really, really cares about
it.
No,
I think the one thing it's used for is to be able to play competition that's going to be in the World Cup. That's it.
Exactly.
And so it's a good chance to just see how you stack up against them. It's almost like a freebie.
You know? And it's better for really the continents, really CONCACAF, right? And Asia, so that, because they're always playing against themselves, they don't really get that many opportunities to play against European competition or South American competition.
Right. When do you get a chance to play against teams like Germany? Not often.
Exactly. So you get to see where you actually stack up. So that it's really a bigger benefit for the teams themselves that make it over, and the countries themselves that make it over, like for the fans, right?
Right.
Because it's not always the most watched tournament. It's not always, they don't necessarily always send the best players.
No. It's kind of a waste, but they're replacing it with a playoff. So because it's going to go to 48 teams,
Yeah, so what's going to happen is because the next World Cup is in Qatar.
And it's in the winter.
It's in the winter. Now so this is the opportunity. Like, it doesn't make sense to have a Confederations Cup.
FIFA's like, we don't want to go to Qatar twice. Okay? So
we don't want to go to Qatar once.
Yeah.
But we're forced to because of all the corruption that we...
We're forced to because of all this money we have now.
They gave us so much money.
So much money.
So some people are weirded out about this, and I think the concern is whatever replaces it, I don't think it's going to be like immediate. But there is that the biggest concern is really for CONCACAF. They're going to be like, hey, the U.S. for the U.S. It's going to like, how are we going to ever get, because the U.S. usually wins the Gold Cup.
Yeah.
That's their main concern. Like, when are we going to get the opportunity to actually play these European teams outside of friendlies, you know, in real competitive games? And
Gold Cup might be going away too.
Yeah, that's another weird one.
Everything's going away.
Is the Gold Cup not a, I know, wasn't it Chuck Blazer that created that?
I believe Chuck Blazer and Jack Warner did. Yeah,
yeah, so the heroes.
The Corruption Cup.
The Mount Rushmore of U.S. soccer.
Why is it going down, though, as opposed to going up?
The Corruption Cup would be just great.
Corruption Cup, yo.
Why not just embrace it, you know?
You know? It's who you are now. There's no such thing as bad publicity, okay?
So
R. Kelly's streams went up after that Lifetime show, then we can do a Corruption Cup, folks.
So Carlos Cordero has like
the trophy is a bag of money. You have been handed the Chuck Blazer Corruption Cup trophy.
The Chuck Blazer Most Valuable Player Award
goes to whoever has the most red cards.
Oh man!
God, we got to do this. They bring it out in a rascal. You get to stay in the cat's apartment for a month.
If Carl Martino would have won, we would have been pitching these ideas hard.
We would have been able to get the cabinet meeting. Yeah, would have been pitching it.
Every you know U.S. soccer meeting, just all these texts from us while Carl Martino's there. I'm like,
his phone just. And he's like, I want to apologize. The Cooligans think it's a good idea too.
All right.
And he looks up. He's like. Corruption Cup, great. So we're going to go back to the docket, back to our minutes.
Why don't we get rid of this Beckham statue and put up a statue of Sepp Blatter. Yeah.
But like Sepp Blatter looking under a table for an envelope. Okay?
Okay, we got the ideas, all right? We just need somebody to execute.
That's it. I mean, we're creatively there. It's just the functionality of making it.
Okay, it's all this red tape that's stopping us from getting our brilliant ideas out there.
And if you think people don't want to be a part of it, just let me tell you, we don't know, okay? But we think they do.
Okay, it's called a feeling, Kyle.
Yeah. Well, you never had a hunch, my guy?
Okay. I feel like we're like Trump's cabinet talks the way we do to him.
100%. We're both Don Jr. and Michael Flynn in this entire situation. What? Hold on. Laws? Ain't no laws,
okay,
dog.
Okay, what are you talking about?
Bro, it's called the Corruption Cup.
They don't call me the Manafort of soccer for nothing.
Yeah, yeah. Bro, it's called the Corruption Cup. Of course we're going to say the winner before there's games, man. Nobody plays. That's the genius.
We need to get Vegas involved quickly.
Yeah. Just call them. You know what? Just follow my lead. Watch who I bet on.
Oh, man. So we'll see. So the next couple of years are going to be very, transformative for U.S. soccer because it's going the tournaments that we sort of, I don't want to say we necessarily grew up with, but that are the modern era of U.S. soccer.
How we see it today is gone.
Yeah, it's going to be very different, especially by the time the 2026 World Cup comes around. The 2026 will be the 48-team World Cup, right? That's the first one?
Yeah.
Okay. So it'll be interesting. So we'll see what this, like, playoff will look like or whatever. Is it going to be like there'll be a playoff to get into like the final two spots or something like that?
No, I think it's a playoff to get like in the final like 10 or 12.
Man, I'm curious
just let everybody in. if it's a World Cup, let the whole world play.
Yeah, yeah. I just call it World War III. Why not?
World Soccer War I. Let's just do it.
I mean, just imagine like the next, like, you know, what is it? It's 32 now. So the last like five teams, what are those? where are they going to be? You know what I mean? Like, yeah. It's Bermuda. Yeah. And, like, yeah. Somewhere. It's going to be somebody.
Fiji. Yeah.
DR, Cuba. Yeah. It's going to be somebody. Like, we're going to be like, what? Yeah. Who made it?
Unfortunately, we lost that game to Belize. So, we're not going into the World Cup.
So, Germany's out. Yeah.
Once again, we would have won the Confederations Cup.
So,
get Kyle Martino's men on the phone. We have an idea.
So, a couple other things. Champions League is coming up, right? You've already seen a game. Is it Yahoo Sports that's going to be
Yahoo
airing?
Sports is
English.
English going to be airing the Confederations Champions League. I'm sorry, the CONCACAF Champions League.
Yeah.
I think it's just the Yahoo Sports app. Okay. I don't think you have to get like a Yahoo Sports TV app. I think it's just the Yahoo Sports.
Okay,
app.
So that's exciting because what was it? It was only like Fubo.
Fubo, I think, was it, and then their website or Go 90. Was Go 90.
Yeah, that
but
was
Go 90's done.
That's how we watched it last year.
That's how bad it was. Go 90 shut down. Verizon pulled the plug.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. No, sorry, I didn't know that. All
it's
right.
Done.
So at least we're going to be able to see the games. Usually in the initial rounds, when there's more teams, it's harder to find the games in general, just because there's too many and nobody wants to cover them. That's really the big issue.
It really is like a high school kid on a camcorder filming these two.
So hopefully Yahoo handles it well. So there was another. So it's starting today, but the We saw a tweet. This was from Jonathan Denta, who is like a big. He's like the guy at NYCFC games that is like always sitting front row, whether the game is home or away.
Mm-hmm.
You if there's a camera guy on an NYCFC fan, especially at an away game,
it's him.
Sideline,
yeah,
it's Jonathan Denta.
You're getting this guy in the shot.
He's just a NYCFC super fan, and he had tweeted out, and this was a reminder because NYCFC is not a part of the CONCACAF Champions League. Which
no, but did you see the information that came out?
What information?
That how they missed it?
Yes, but we sort of talked about this because we weren't sure.
Yeah, we were like, how the hell did that happen?
Yeah, because what we heard was...
Well, they what do you mean we heard? It was official. They made it official that they were in, and they were like, psych.
We gotcha.
Ah.
So this was in 2017 when NYCFC were the they had the highest point total in the league. Beneath the MLS Cup champion Toronto FC. Toronto FC won MLS Cup and they also won the Canadian Cup. So that's two spots for the CONCACAF Champions League. So it goes to the highest points.
Which was NYCFC.
So.
But then a couple months later, they're like, no, no, no. It's the highest points.
I would
over
say a couple days
seasons.
Later. It wasn't even like that long. It was like maybe a week or two. And then it was like, oh, it's not the person, not the team that has the highest points. It's the team that has the highest points combined from 2017 and 2018.
Right. So it's over the 2 years.
Over the 2 years. So they changed it. After CONCACAF, the official CONCACAF Twitter handle, the media handle, CONCACAF Media, tweeted out that congratulations, NYCFC, you are now in the Champions League.
Wait to see you.
Can't wait to see you there, buddy.
You what?
Yeah, as soon as you're like, okay, cool, well, I'm going to start planning, like, where do you want to meet up? And they're like, oh, wait, hold on a
who
second.
Who told you?
Oh, because there's this, like... I actually swipe right on this other dude named Atlanta United. And like
actually Red Bulls have their spot now.
Red Bulls have the spot, but because they won a supporter shield.
Right. No, but yes. No.
No.
It was because of the points.
No. I think it would have. It's the same thing. Like if it was only 2017, NYCFC would be in this.
Right, but it was because it was the 2 years. Red Bull took their spot. Atlanta got in because they won MLS Cup.
Oh, okay. For whatever reason, I thought Atlanta United had more points combined from more than NYCFC, which I think they did from 2017.
They did as well.
And 2018.
They did as well.
Okay.
But it was Red Bull.
Red Bull ended up taking it. Yeah. I'm just saying, in 2017, Atlanta United Whatever. It doesn't matter.
Since when do facts matter on this podcast?
But it was an interesting thing. So he had pointed it out that at least thank you for the reminder that CONCACAF was like, nah, it ain't happening for you.
Oh, we ain't playing no games in no baseball stadium. Come down here to San Salvador.
it begs a question, like, why did that happen to begin with? Why did it get to the point where they awarded NYCFC and then took it back?
Well, if there's one thing I know about CONCACAF is that they always follow the rules and they seem to really have all their shit together.
They're making up the rules as they go, right? Because they changed the format of the tournament. The tournament used to be a group stage and then a knockout round.
Buddy, we're all making up our own rules as we go along. MLS is like, you know what, LA? Just have the four DPs, honestly, at this point.
So let's talk about that. Gio Dos Santos.
I know, it's called a segue, baby.
Gio Dos Santos. We were talking about it a couple weeks ago that in the next couple days that LA Galaxy would have to make something was going to happen where either Gio Dos Santos was going to either give up money or they were going to buy him out.
They were going to loan him or trade
him or something. But then we were realizing nobody wants Gio Dos Santos.
Nobody wants Gio Dos Santos.
Jonah Dos Santos doesn't seem to want Gio Dos Santos.
No, Jonah's like, look, I mean, at least I got the apartment to myself again, you know?
But as of this moment, it's February 19th. The season starts on March 2nd. Los Angeles Galaxy have 4 designated players. And they are not allowed to. They can only have 3.
Yeah, that's one more than the rule allows.
So,
and the joke has always been that they can have as many DPs as they want. They're like, well, I mean, you see it on Twitter. We don't have to make a decision.
And Paul Tenorio on The Athletic wrote a great article about it, just about like what is going on, and just really calling out Major League Soccer, being like, yo, what are you guys going to do?
Look over here, everybody.
And it's a rough position for everybody involved. Zlatan arrives, plays very well, earns all this money. You know, what was it? How long has he been? This is his 3rd year with the Galaxy, right? He
got Zlatan?
No,
Gio. Yeah.
So, there, you know, he injuries, not really playing well when he was healthy. You can understand why LA Galaxy want to work something out. So the last I heard, it was that they are planning to restructure the deal.
He's going to get his deal restructured. That's the whole thing. And he's willing.
They're going to give him the Bobby Bonilla deal that the Mets.
They just push it all to a few years from now.
He's going to get $1 million a year for 40 years or something like that.
They're just like, let somebody else handle this shit. You know, someone in the future.
They got to figure something out because from Paul Tenorio's article, he's anonymously quoting other MLS executives, and they're all saying like, basically like, you know, it's a shit show. What the hell? This is insulting. This is like, it's ridiculous.
Imagine he doesn't agree to whatever that restructure clause is.
Yeah.
And imagine he just has to be a DP and LA Galaxy get a DP and MLS didn't pass the rule that allows that until 1 or 2 days before the season starts. And every other team's like, wait, hold on.
Exactly.
So we could have went out and got another guy.
Yeah.
And you didn't tell us nothing until now.
Yeah.
This is insanity.
Oh, you don't understand. We created the DP allocation money 5 minutes before kickoff of the 2019 season.
So why didn't you do this weeks ago, do this thing that I told you about right now?
That's on you for not like really looking into the fine print.
Oh, you're going to judge that? Well, guess what? Now, everybody can't get into CONCACAF Champions League. It's only the teams that have had the high scores over the last 15 years. All right, Atlanta, you're out.
All right, so look, I don't know what to tell you, but the Tampa Bay Mutiny are now in the CONCACAF Champions League.
You know, Miami Fusion might win this whole thing. Okay?
Okay, we've expressed the rules very clearly. Yeah. I don't know what's going on.
Welcome to CONCACAF Champions League, Chivas USA. What you want to say about that right now? Huh? You got a big opinion about this 4DP?
Oh, and
I'm going to pull this minivan around.
Speaking of Major League Soccer, someone who's going to have a big influence on whether Gio Dos Santos remains or what LA Galaxy situation is, Don Garber gets a new contract.
5 years.
5 years. Remember, everyone was talking about, these might be his last few years. He's trying to you know, get these new teams and leave a legacy for himself. And,
nah,
and
all, bro.
He's like, nah, I ain't going nowhere.
I'm going to write the beginning of that legacy.
Okay. I'm going to write the New Testament right now.
Yes, son. Guess what? There's no crucifixion in this Old Testament.
Okay. You seen Passion of the Christ? He don't die at the end now.
I'm Donnie G. I got abs.
So, Don Garber, we all expected like an announcement of his retirement soon.
Yeah, all of us. We talked about it.
Well, didn't we, when we were talking, not at MLS Cup, but I think like during All-Star.
The Hall of Fame.
Hall of Fame. Didn't
we talk to him?
He seemed like this, you know, it was everything like.
Well, he was like, he was
wrapping it up.
Yeah, he was putting the bow on.
Yeah,
it.
Yeah.
That's how he came across.
Yeah, he seemed, and you know what?
No, this was All-Star because he didn't talk to us at the Hall of Fame. I think he was nervous about a speech.
Oh, that's right.
This is All-Star. He came over, he was just chatting shit, tossing shit around.
During his Hall of Fame speech, his induction speech, he did speak very past tense and what I've done. And
yes, what I was able to do, like that kind of stuff.
So it didn't sound like he was thinking about like, all right, we're trying to get, you know, Sacramento in this league.
Oh, it wasn't campaigning.
No, not at all. So it did seem very much like it was winding down.
Right, it was end of second term.
And he also seemed, not that Hall of Famer, I think maybe it was that All-Star, he genuinely seemed tired.
Yeah, and just relieved.
Just tired of all this.
Yeah, he was like,
I got to deal with all the pro rel questions and all, and Lala's asking me about Columbus. Yeah. And the crew and all. And like,
he just did seem done with it all.
Yeah. And
but there was like a sense of relief. It was like a calmness. His shoulders were a little lower.
Yeah, yeah.
He came over. He was just like, hey, what's up, guys?
You know? So it seems like maybe by MLS Cup, he may have known like he was already negotiating a new deal because he seemed a little bit more positive. Right?
He was 100%.
Laughing with us and stuff like that.
So, and I'll tell you this much. I forgot to tell you this. Probably should have told you this off air, but whatever. I think that conversation stuck with him because it turns out that someone who, one of my representatives knows someone who's related to him.
Okay.
And started working the angles at a party to get a conversation with him.
Yeah, yeah.
Talked to Donnie G. And she was like, hey, I represent Alexis. He's one of the Cooligans. And he was like, I love those guys.
Okay.
That was a quote.
That was a quote. That definitely, several people will hate that they said that he said that.
But it's because we were just sitting there shooting the shit with him, and we made him laugh. I made fun of him. I said he looked like a narc at parties.
we had a good time with Danny G. So,
but also, if you think we're shills, we will get paid and we will be shills, okay?
Well, we are currently not shills.
We're not shills now.
But when that happens, we will make it very clear.
You will know when we land in our helicopter. With a World Cup Comedy Tour sponsored by Audi, Continental Tire, and Target. Guess what, my guy?
Had nothing to do. What do you mean? Had nothing to do with MLS.
I don't even know why you would pair those two together.
This 6 degrees of separation is not even. I don't even know how.
Maybe had more to do with Kevin Bacon than it did Donnie G. Uncle Donnie. I mean, did I say Uncle?
So I'm actually pretty surprised, especially with the Columbus scenario, that he did get a new contract. I think that's, it was a stressful, 2018 was a stressful year for Major League Soccer. And I can see that the owners would have been a bit frustrated with how Don Garber may have handled the situation.
How did he get this contract knowing that there's 4 DPs sitting out in LA?
But it seems like his influence to grow the league is,
He makes money.
He makes everyone too much money.
Yeah.
And he's charming. And look, he's charmed us.
Oh my God. We're the most dead inside. And 5 seconds into talking to him, I'm like, is that a big guy? You know, our voice goes up. What are you talking about?
It's fun. Donnie, you're so funny.
I wish people could see the side of you.
You don't know him like I know him.
I know. I know what he seems like to you. But when we're alone, we're just feet up on the couch drinking wine. Stop, guys.
So he makes too much money.
He makes the league too much money. You're not gonna say no to to the goose that laid the golden egg.
Yeah, and look, people hate him and they have issues and they feel like he's stifling the league and American soccer and whatever. But he makes.
Then you got your Kevin Payne's out there.
He makes a small amount of people a lot of money.
Yeah.
And that's just, that is what it is. So.
And, you know, all jokes aside, he did grow the league.
He did.
Like, it may not be the way everybody wants,
mm-hmm.
but if that's what they set out to do, at a time when they were losing teams. And he did it.
Yep.
He didn't do it the way I would have done it, but he did it.
Exactly.
So if you're one of those owners, you're like, yeah, I'm not going to. What am I going to bring up? Kyle Martino? You know what I mean? Look at the guys he's with, and you just see us over there.
Yeah. Well, now we got sad. That's a sad reality.
Yeah.
Capitalism wins again.
Sorry, folks.
So, a couple other things before we get to our interview with Kyle Martino. Let's talk about NYCFC, who just dropped their new jersey.
You sure you don't want to talk about how you're going to have to move to Orlando?
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Let's talk about it. Okay, so I got my plane ticket. I've already been training a little bit.
Yeah, what people don't know is you went to Colorado for a physical. The kid is going to Orlando. Nani.
That's right. Luis.
Signed for free by Orlando.
That's right. Nobody wanted him.
No, his own team was like, you can have him. Here's the thing. Is he past it? Yeah. Is he good enough to be a winger? Probably not. Is he going to get shocked by the physicality and the speed and the athleticism in this league? Absolutely.
Yes.
Would you do it? Yeah, it's free.
Without a doubt.
Why would you not bring Nani in for free?
Yeah, he's only 32 years old.
Free.
So, I'm only 32 years old.
Yes.
So if you don't, we're talking about Nani, and because for all of Nani's career, people have told me I look exactly like him.
In fact, our friend Andrew over in Manchester,
that's right,
made a beautiful phone lock screen.
Yes, just a wallpaper.
just a bunch of cutouts of you. And there's a little bit of an Easter egg in there. One of them is Nani.
That's right. And I love Andrew, and I love that he did that, because not only is it every time I show it to somebody, they're like, all right, well, you have a stalker.
Yeah.
That's always makes me laugh. But I love looking at that collage because it's like a reminder of everything we've done throughout the Cooligans.
It's got the two Xbox remotes as phones.
That's right.
Which just brings me so much joy when I think about that.
We've had so many fun moments, and I look at that and I'm like, look at, we did that and that and that, and all these different experiences, all the times we've gotten to travel, all the dumb videos we've made, and it's nostalgic.
Yeah.
It makes me happy. So thank you, Andrew.
A little This Is Your Life.
Yeah, it is kind of nice, you know? But yes, Luis Nani signed with Orlando City, 3-year deal. I don't know how much did they say how much he's getting paid?
They did not, but I think he's a DP. A DP.
So he's probably I imagine he's somewhere in like the $2 to $4 million.
I was
going
to say 2 to 3. Okay.
Yeah. I imagine that. So,
By the way, if Orlando, where's the two dudes with the phone, with the Plátano phone?
That's right.
We need to call them from our Plátano.
Okay.
Because if one of the chants for him isn't "Ooh, nani, nani, nani," "Ooh, nani, nani, nani,"
that should be.
If
there.
That's not that, then we failed as a culture, as a podcast. Then seventh graders listen to this. You're listening to two failures. We aren't your heroes.
We've let you down. we're terrible to you, and also your damn teachers are terrible to you.
In
for
fact,
letting
if
you
that's
listen.
If that's not one of the chants, you all have detention and extra homework.
So, So I think this is this is what I'm realizing with Orlando, right? And Orlando, I love them because they stick to their identity, right?
Yeah.
And their identity is
under a hat.
If you're Brazilian or you speak Portuguese,
you
fit right in on this team, okay?
Right. You know what a feijoada is? Get up in here.
That's it. There is no other prerequisite for who belongs on this team. You know a couple Portuguese words, and you're in there.
You know what they do? They're like, "Oh, you wanna play for Orlando?" They lift the box, and there's just a little pastéis de nata. And they're like, "What's that?" And then someone's like, "Is that a custard?" And he's like, "You're off the team." Someone else is like, "Oh, it's pastéis de nata. I love those." All right, give him a DP contract. Right. That's our 50P right there.
So, but I'm excited to see Nani in Orlando.
You think he makes Orlando better?
I think they sign someone from the U12 Academy, it makes Orlando better. They're having a rough time.
The fact that we laugh.
I gotta say,
like, James O'Connor is getting an entire preseason with them, so I'm excited to see what happens.
Orlando, all they're missing is a, they have the excitement, they have the great stadium. They just need some direction. And from my understanding, James O'Connor is a much more attack-minded coach. Nani, I don't think he's played defense in 20 years.
And he's not going to be asked
He's not going to be asked to. No. So,
if we lose the ball, possession of the ball, just walk it off, baby.
Look, Joe Bendick is gone. I believe it's not Kellen Rowe. Brian Rowe,
yeah,
new keeper, left Vancouver, going to Orlando. And Brian Rowe was pretty good with LA Galaxy for a while. And hopefully that it's just defensively, right? That's their weakness. They need to focus on some kind of defensive anything. And maybe Brian Rowe provides that a little bit better than Joe Bendick.
Well,
and
they're going with a three man back line.
So it's gonna be seven
to nine,
not to nine goals every game. It's just gonna be a goal fest for them. hopefully, Dwyer, Nani. Like, I mean, it's gonna be more fun to watch.
That's true.
My concern I expect more from is from Sasha Kljestan. I hope that he, because he's not necessarily the fastest player. He's not the most dynamic per se, but he's a good passer, right? He was the assist king a couple years ago with New York Red Bulls. Hopefully, he can kind of recreate that, and I hope Nani can help him with that.
Well, I mean, he steps into where Justin Merrim left, right? He's better than Justin Merrim, I think.
Definitely in Orlando. Justin Merrim was a nightmare.
Well, yeah. I don't know. Let's wait to see if he cries and wants to go to Columbus instead.
Imagine. That'd be great. So what else? Let's talk about Jonathan Lewis
Yotun. I'm sorry. He's replacing Yotun.
Yoshima Yotun. He went to Mexico.
Cruz Azul,
yes. So,
By the way, you saw that Gignac goal, the back heel?
I did.
God, Yaru.
That was.
That was disrespectful. Families should be threatened after that.
That was beautiful. It is. I feel like watching him score that goal,
he's the highest paid player in Liga MX.
But most goals for Tigres, I think, already or something like that, right? But Gignac, you start seeing, just watching him there, he's French, and you realize like how few players make that move. Like, where is Liga MX in that, like in the global market? I mean, it's like there's that pipeline to Central America, South America. There's a lot of Colombians, Argentinians, things like that. But there's not the European going to
None.
Mexico. It's a good league. It's a popular league. But is there something fundamentally is something wrong where European players don't really want to go over there?
I think it's that part of nobody knows how much they make.
Okay.
Because they don't release player information or contract information. They do double contracts. So they're like, all right, here's the legal one that will show to the government for your taxes. And here's the real one. You know, they do stuff like that. And I think, Herc has talked about that a lot because he played down there. It's just one of those leagues where it's like you're not guaranteed to get paid.
Okay.
So
you can see why European players may not want to.
Yeah. I mean, the rumor is that Gignac gets paid a salary, but he also gets like jewels.
Yeah. We've talked about this before.
So it's like, I mean, how many
At first you said that, I'm like, no, Alexis, that's stupid. That's not possible. And then I think something came out where there was like some other form of payment, like where he was getting, when you say jewels, it sounds like,
he gets a satchel.
Like DuckTales or something. Like he's jumping in a pool of coins.
Yeah.
But it was apparently some a jeweler that was like a part of the deal or the contract or something. And there's something strange like that. So you can see why European players may not want to be there, but Gignac is just like, I want dropping all the ice, put all the ice on me.
Do it. I don't even have to check the weather. I know it's going to rain. I'm dripping so hard right now.
But yeah, it was an incredible goal. Right. And then the angle from the field was incredible. And we got to go to Mexico for a game, man.
Yes, we do. We got to go to Tigres, man.
Tigres or Cholos.
Hang out with Rob Schneider. You know, he's a big Tigres fan because he married a Mexican woman who's a massive Tigres fan.
Okay.
So he's like the emotional leader of the Tigres fans. They put him on camera all the time. Yeah. He's always there.
He's always like, you can do it.
Yeah. No, really, they do that, actually. They 100% do that. And you know how like Spike Lee is like the Knicks, like they'll put him on camera. Okay. He's the Spike Lee of...
Yeah, why can't we be that for somebody?
Yo, let's be Spike Lee of like Lobos Buap. You know? But we'll change the name to Logos. Lobos Guap.
That's right.
That's right, son.
Let's talk about NYCFC for a second. Jonathan Lewis in the news again.
Can't get out.
For being great at soccer, right?
Well, too great. Actions.
Well, we were talking about him after those friendlies.
We've been talking about him since the friendlies.
Since the friendlies for, against Panama and against Costa Rica, he got 2 assists in those games. He was dynamic. He was exciting to watch, and we were glad. We were like, yo, America. Look at this kid. We see him every week on the bench at NYCFC. Yeah.
We're not even in the 18. He's just walking around eating popcorn.
So we were kind of curious, what was Dome's response? Because after...
Well, he's been asked. He finally gave an answer.
Yeah, because after the friendlies for the men's national team, we were like...
He was pushing the corner a little bit. Like, he was like... Yeah. They're like, you got to start him now.
You got to have to give him some time, right? He's playing too well.
Yeah.
And but Dome keeps it Dome, right?
He said... Lewis remains a work in progress, albeit... this isn't him. This is quoting the article by... Yeah. Christian Dyer.
Yeah.
He says, Lewis remains a work in progress, albeit a talented one, says NYCFC head coach Torrent. Okay, never mind. He did say that. This is to quote him. It's not enough to do two amazing actions, said the coach in reference to Lewis's assists with the national team. Soccer isn't about what happens when you have the ball, but what happens when you don't have the ball. Okay. I got to be honest, though, coach. I feel like, and this might be why the team played so badly. I feel like what happens when you have the ball should be pretty important. I feel like that maybe is how you lead to scores.
Yeah, we got to like maybe prioritize that a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. You know, you're not just the defensive coach, right?
So, yes, he did mention that. And he, he's basically telling everybody, relax.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah.
He made a couple of little passes here and there.
Oh, wow. Potential. We've known about that.
We know he can pass the ball. Yeah, yeah. Right?
But he basically said, like, he's got to get his head on straight, is essentially what he said.
Yeah. And to quote Dome, he says, if you want to become a top player, you have to be focused in everything in your life, because I watched the games. He played 10 minutes in the second game. He played 25 minutes. I repeat, it's not enough to do two actions. Soccer in general is about 90 minutes. It is about 90 minutes. It is also about 60 minutes. So,
wait, what?
This is Dome, right?
He's like 60 minutes, Sunday morning, PTI.
We need a Dome translator, yeah. Okay?
What the hell are you saying, dude?
Obviously, he's mentioning like that. Even as if he starts and plays 60 minutes, he doesn't do enough to earn that starting role, because even though he's good one-on-one, he can attack, he doesn't do the things necessary throughout the entire game to earn a starting spot or to earn those 90 minutes.
I mean, look, he's got to become way more dedicated to soccer. I mean, it's something that we've heard rumblings of in the past.
Yep.
That he doesn't really care. He doesn't focus. He just shows up. He knows he has a lot of talent. He wants to just show up and do fancy stuff. You know what I mean? He doesn't want to put in the work. He doesn't want to be dedicated to soccer on a day-to-day basis. I get it. You know, I don't think that the greatest players in the world are always like that. Not everyone is Jordan, you know? Sometimes sure. You get a meta world peace.
Oh, yeah. You know, throwing elbows. That still counts for something. You need a guy like that on your team.
Maybe you need somebody to fight someone in the stands. The wrong guy, too. Like, you need players like this every once in a while. Like, I love Diego Maradona, and no one's going to say that he wasn't completely dedicated to the sport, but there were times.
Yeah, he was a little distracted.
Well, when he didn't have the ball, we'll say. He had maybe an 8 ball, is what I'm trying to say. Like, you know what I mean? Let's just say he provided himself with some distractions. Same thing with Ronaldinho.
Okay. You know? Some people drink Red Bull. Some people do what Maradona did.
Some people want a Red Bull. He wanted a white horse. You know what I mean? Like, there's different things, is what I'm saying, you know?
So, this is...
Clearly not the same player. I can hear the Argentinian fans typing,
but this is... Jonathan Lewis, the Jonathan Lewis dilemma, to me, is a little... I think they're being a bit harsh on him.
But he's also young. That's what you got to do to a player that's
young. But he's also not a maniac, right? I don't know. I haven't seen one story of Jonathan Lewis being like wildly irresponsible. Maybe he's a little, he might be tardy, or he may be not be like the most, like,
he's immature,
maybe a little immature, but
again, we're speculating. We don't know.
There was a litany of people, a long history of people who are known to be a bit of a problem, but you got to play them, right?
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that Jonathan Lewis is the Diego Costa of MLS or the Balotelli or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. But he's not an issue. I just think he may be rubbing his coach the wrong way.
Yeah, it's like comparatively, you know.
Buddy, rub him the right way.
Rub him the right way.
Get out there. Play some Jade.
So I just think he's earned at least a little bit of a longer leash. That's all I'm saying. It's just like to get the little amount of minutes that he's gotten, and for the coach to harp on this stuff, you know, he's publicly always saying he needs to focus on this and immaturity and whatever. And, you know, I'm paraphrasing, but that kind of stuff, I'm like, he's earned some privacy.
Yeah.
About that stuff. He's playing well enough where you're like, all right, we're just not going to, just throw him under the bus every opportunity somebody asks about him, because everyone is asking the questions. And you know how they were, Doma had the flare up with Christian Arreos, right?
Right.
And everybody who asks about Jonathan, he gets annoyed. And it's like, well, it doesn't make sense because he's playing so well.
He's a player that people are looking at and going, wow, he's good. You're going to get asked about
So prepare to be annoyed a little bit.
Yeah, you're going
to
get annoyed, bro. This ain't Spain.
Yeah, if NYCFC is just crushing and wins all their games and they without Jonathan Lewis, then nobody's going to ask.
No one's going to care.
But
that ain't happening.
That's not that one.
And he's looking good in a much more pressure situation than playing in an MLS regular season match, which is mainly when he plays. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's valid. So, I just wanted to, before we get to our interview with Kyle, I just wanted to make sure to say thank you to everyone who listened to our interview with Ali Krieger.
Oh, we got such great feedback. We got one negative feedback.
And this is us. We don't have to talk about it, but well, we have to.
Of course. Because of course we're going to bring it up.
We're comedians who cannot, as soon as we hear like if everyone hated it, it'll be like,
We did something wrong.
But if one person hates it, we're like...
And by the way, this person isn't wrong. What they suggested did happen, right? But it wasn't... It was a loud conference. This was a rushed interview.
Yeah.
She basically, somebody tweeted at us, I think it's a woman, tweeted at us saying...
I don't know who it was. I don't know if
I believe it was a woman, but they said, I couldn't... such a terrible interview. You kept talking over her. Shut up and let her speak. Something like that.
Yeah. I don't know if they said shut up.
All right. Well, that's how I heard it. I may be paraphrasing. Imagine they were like really nice, big fan of the show. We were not hearing each other really well. And because she didn't have headphones and I didn't have headphones on, only you did.
Yeah.
Like, I think we were just talking as in a group. So the fact that it was in a microphones, it's only when you hear it that you're like, oh.
Yeah,
that a little bit of talking over each other.
But also, this isn't 60 minutes. A Sunday morning news show.
Domi Torrent's not watching this.
So it's a comedy show.
Yeah,
so,
underneath us, you don't hear bit 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 bit.
So we have you have to get your words in, and it's fast and whatever. So sometimes we're gonna talk over each other, and especially in a loud environment like that, in a convention center, it's also
in a very casual interview.
Yes, and also where we were genuinely rushed, where like there were three people who were like
standing
standing in front of us, being just staring at us like, how long are you gonna do this? She has to go.
So
to the person who was a little frustrated that we were talking over her a little bit, it happens.
Yeah.
It's fun. We're having a good time.
Hopefully you listen to
Ali
the rest
Krieger
of it.
We were talking over her. She was talking over us.
Yeah.
She was making jokes. She made us laugh. She's amazing. And she wants to be back on the show again.
I can't wait. I can't wait to talk over her next time. Oh, my God.
But so thank you so much for... maybe there's some new listeners that we have that are listening to the show. Thank you who are fans of Ali Krieger. Thank you for sticking with us. She's the best.
She absolutely is.
And we're going to do, if you are a fan of, other NWSL players or women's national team players that you think should be on the show, let us know. Let us know what you think. We want to talk to, she mentioned Megan Rapinoe and Klingenberg and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So we want to have fun conversations like that to show a side, women's soccer players, professional soccer players, whatever, we want to bring comedy to that world as well.
Yeah.
And So
top of our list is Allie Krieger. Yes. Back on. Second, J.J. Watt's girlfriend. Alehi.
Ohio. Yeah.
Let's get her on, dude.
I was going to say Abby Wambach, but whatever.
Yeah, no, of course. Alex Morgan. Yeah, they're on there.
Carly Lloyd.
They're all on there. Top of the list, Allie. Second, J.J. Watt's girl. Ohio.
And J.J. Watt on the show. We got to, so she can put him on her.
J.J. Watt doesn't get a microphone. He's got to grab Ohio's when she's not talking.
So. So thank you again for that. And all right, so let's get to our interview with Kyle Martino. This happened in Chicago for the United Soccer Coaches Convention. Thank you again for the United Soccer Coaches inviting us out there.
And he was a blast. He was relaxed. He's trying to push soccer in the hood and on basketball courts.
Yeah, Street FC, which is if you've are in soccer Twitter or soccer Instagram, you may have seen Street FC, which is
also that goal thing he has.
Yes, that's right. Golfer. So it is he has a new project where he's trying to do what basically happens in Europe, where on basketball courts there is a goal under it, like a metal cage basically, yeah, under it, so that it can be used for both sports.
Or in other words, they put a basketball goal over the soccer goal. They put a basketball rim over it.
That's right. So he's trying to do that here, and he created this cool, really cool system, which he will explain a bit about, about it on our interview. But I got to play a couple games in Street FC. We talked before it was quote unquote Street FC. I was already playing him when he was getting started.
Yeah.
And I was getting nutmegged by Leko Eskandarian.
Yeah.
He's a villain in my life.
Yeah. Just he's my the enemy. Bane of your existence.
My bane. Bane, not Vane.
Oh, there you go. Bane. Is it Bane?
It's Bane of my existence, not Bane of
you. Well, I was thinking Bane. Yeah, I think you all know why.
But they're really dope. If you're in New York, and maybe he'll end up doing this in other cities, but if you're in New York and you follow Street FC, I think it's The Street FC on both platforms, on Twitter and Instagram, and you can hear about it because the games are like, he'll announce it like the day before. And it's,
yeah,
like,
they just happen anywhere and everywhere.
Literally, it's like in different locations. It's almost like an improv everywhere, but for soccer.
Right.
Right? There was a cool one that they did at Washington Square Park.
Washington Square Park is the one I was thinking of when I said they play like anywhere. They have a space.
Yeah.
And they just put it together again.
And professionals might show up.
It's pretty dope.
You never know. So
you might get nutmegged.
You might get nutmegged by Leko Eskandarian. Yeah. Now, and we can, and then the enemy of my enemy is my friend. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And then we will combine our efforts
to really bring him down. So next up is our interview with Kyle Martino at the United Soccer Coaches Convention.
Hey, thank you so much for listening to the episode. We just want to give you a word from our sponsors, us and you.
And you. Thank you so much to all a bunch of new people have been signing up for Gully Squad.
Yeah, we got some people from Europe.
From
now.
Europe.
Wow.
Crazy. We speak so negatively about those Europeans.
Shh, not in the ad, Christian.
Not in the ad. I'm sorry. We love Europeans.
Yeah.
Brexit.
Yeah. Give us all those pounds and euros.
No, but thank you so much for joining up. And so you can go to soccercooligans.com/Gully Squad if you want to help to support the show, be a part of the secret, super secret Facebook group that may or may not exist.
Yeah, you never know.
You never know. And like we had mentioned, I think last week or 2 weeks ago, that we have a nice surprise for all the Gully Squad members.
Yeah.
So
it's coming soon.
It's coming soon. So we just want to get you, whet your appetite a little
bit. Why are you pointing at my? That's not my appetite, Christian. But yeah, if you're a Gully Squad member, you're going to get a nice gift. But the gift that you get, besides what may come in the mail, is you get to possibly be a member of that super secret Facebook group, but also you get to help us out. So it's a big help to us. It's what gets us to all these different cities. We get to do content. We get to talk to these teams. We want to do more of that. We want to give you guys more content each week. The way we do that is with a little help from you guys. Gully Squad is that. Be a part of Gully Squad. Help us get more content for the show. You tell us what you want to hear and see on this show, exactly, and we'll do it. So go to soccercooligans.com/Gully Squad, or you can just go to soccercooligans.com. You'll see it right up at the top. Join Gully Squad. Put some numbers in there, and let's get this thing growing. Yeah, baby, we're back.
Yes.
Come on.
This
is just a parade of stars at this point.
Who's coming?
I know. You heard the voice. I mean, you know, you get a lot of credit for how well you play. No one gives you enough credit for how silky that voice is.
Ooh.
Well. You know,
hold on. If you don't know who this voice is, I mean, where are you? Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the one and the only, unless you're driving.
Kyle Martino, everybody.
You might know me from such shows as Premier League on NBC.
He's got a monocle on. He's snapping his finger.
You know what's funny? You say that. Someone said that. Like, I was repped by CAA, and someone said, "You got a great voice. You should do some voiceover work." So they gave me a voiceover agent, and I went on probably like 30 voiceover auditions and never got close to landing any of them because you need a voice and you kind of need to be able to act. No, I couldn't do either of those.
I do both, and I think voiceovers are harder because you have to act with just your voice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, you still have to be in the character in
your underwear, which is the beauty of that job.
Yeah, that's a beautiful thing.
Someone told me there's like 4 voiceover guys that do like 90% of all the work.
When that guy from In a World, when that guy died, it's like 5 open. People stepped into that one position and everyone else gets like little things. And now it's mostly like John Hamm gets to do Mercedes commercials. Get out of
Come
our
on, lives. John. You're taking jobs from people that need them.
Well, Kyle Martino, welcome to the show.
Which, by the way, John Hamm has a blog just about his bulge. Did you know that?
I didn't know that, but I'm going to subscribe.
He didn't make it. You say it like
that for sure. No. You can't prove that.
It's a burner pod.
It was a burner blog. It's a blog, not a podcast. He's listening to my bulge. All right, Kyle, where's your head at?
I thought it was just him talking about his bulge.
That's hilarious. Week after week.
Although, with his voice, it's probably a great idea.
That TED Talks.
Yeah, nice.
Well, Kyle Martino, we're not here to talk about John Hamm's bulge. We're here to talk about your bulge. Sir, I'm kidding. We're at the United Soccer Coaches Conference, and we are here to talk. You're doing a lot of things. So if you want to talk about the first thing that you're most proud of and excited to be here, about, what is that thing?
That I'm not here this time trying to get votes.
Yes.
I can't tell you how much more fun the convention is when you're not walking around.
Yo, you got close, though.
I got close. I was a second. Second place.
Second place, which was about like...
I'll take that.
Did you think you were going to win? Be honest.
No.
Ah.
But there was a moment where we like, my team was incredible. Thanks, my man. My team was incredible. And so many people put so much time into that campaign. I mean, I had like 40 volunteers behind me. And there was a moment where like... I think this happens in like in every startup or every exciting thing that anyone ever does, or like
or a comedy
anything
career.
Big or a comedy career, where you sat there and you let belief come, you know, like flood
hope.
In
hope
and hope.
Became
and there was
real.
A moment where
That's
like
the biggest mistake.
We sat there and everyone kind of looked at each other and we were all quiet and it was like a great day and we had a lot of cool things and we and someone said, "We're gonna win." And I was like,
the inspiring music goes on. And like,
no, I joke, but honestly, like the goal for the goal I designed is what I'm so proud of, and it's not why I'm here, but I'm so lucky that I was able to unveil it here.
And you and talk about that a little bit more because
you're also doing two things here, though.
Yeah,
you're also here promoting Street FC.
Yeah, so I'm here doing three things.
Yeah,
three things.
And then, obviously, I've got a stand-up slot tonight.
Yeah,
at 3 a.m.
I was gonna say, Christian and I are barely doing one thing. You know what I mean?
And we're doing it well. We're doing it well. So, Golfer will get to Street FC. We'll get to Street Soccer USA is the nonprofit that after the election I was honored. They asked me to chair. Been around for 10 years. Incredible organization. Started by two brothers, Lawrence and Rob, that had their house burned down in Charlotte over a decade ago and were homeless overnight and used soccer to get back on their feet. And it's amazing what they built, and it's changing the lives of so many kids in our program. So I'm here to speak on a grassroots panel with Lawrence and others doing great things in the grassroots space tomorrow. Street FC is the easiest way to describe it, that I don't love this way to describe it, but it is the easiest to conceptualize it, is the soul cycle of pickup soccer. Just an amazing, like, you know, just tight pants, you know, gold bikes, I don't know. It's
kind of like a cult.
Yeah. It's an on-demand, very specific format, inclusive, on-demand pickup soccer game that is played on hard surfaces.
Yeah,
so
and I got
that's
to,
fun.
I got
I
to
love that one.
I got to play once in the beginning.
That was before, like, we were We were pre, that was a startup.
Yes, exactly. And I got to see it and I got to experience.
You were part of the proof of concept.
Yes. Yes. But and when I first heard about it, I'm like, okay, cool. Kyle Martino's posting, asking people to come out to, you know, play some pickup. I'm like, all right, a bunch of Kyle Martino's fans and friends will go out and play. But apparently, everyone who is a supporter of Kyle Martino is also a professional soccer player. All right. I didn't expect all of that.
Well, we had just finished recording an episode and Christian's like, I think I'm going to go do this pickup game. And Christian's like, do you want to go? I'm like, I'm not playing against Cal Martino. I shouldn't even be playing against two-year-olds. Like, look at me. I'm not going to play against Cal Martino. And he's like, I think I'm going to go. And then all I heard about is he got nutmegged like 58 times.
I got nutmegged by Aleko Escandari and still have not forgiven
him.
I'll
tell you this. I tend to stock certain games and curate a pretty high level fun experience. But you showing up is what it's all about. Because what I'm building is a inclusive... gender neutral, age neutral, quality of play neutral, where everyone has a place to go to belong. Everyone joins a club that they feel a part of something special, and then you be in the game that you're supposed to be in. Yeah. So there's a lot we're so excited to show people. Dennis Crowley, who started Foursquare, is my partner in it. We're pumped because I believe in it, but you always believe in, you know, what you come up with, and you think you're like the smartest person ever, and 95% of that's terrible. This thing is...
Look at this. We came up with this podcast, so look at the sign. It's the funniest soccer
podcast. You knew it was going to succeed alone, right? I'm so excited. I have to be kind of coy because there's a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff we're building, and it's going to be out soon, and it's going to be awesome, and you guys are going to be a part of it. But the golfer is kind of the last piece of why I'm here.
Yeah, and that's a thing that we talk about a lot because in a lot of other countries, all basketball courts are pretty much – it's like soccer fields with backboards on there.
Yeah, they allow them to put hoops over their soccer
goals.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. So golfer, if you don't know – during your campaign, you talked a lot about over-unders, which is the combination of a soccer goal, like a small soccer goal for a five-a-side, with a basketball rim on top, so you can still play basketball.
Which isn't my idea. I mean, like you said.
Yeah.
But that was a part of your campaign. You were talking about it.
Well,
But we're from the hood. So for us, this is huge because this is a way to get... like hood kids in the soccer, or at least give them the ability to play.
It's not a way you can. It's a way literally every kid is accessing the game everywhere in the world, regardless of your socioeconomic status.
Right.
That stripped down, pick up, winner stays. That's the pure like acoustic session.
Right.
You know, like Eric Clapton. I mean,
that's where you get the flair.
That's where you see like the beauty of the game, untouched, creative, and. And it's an amazing world, and it's organic, and it's beautiful. Here we have to curate it and help it a little bit because.
Can I just stop you for 1 second? Because
country.
In our shot is Jimmy Conrad's behind.
I 100% thought you were just doing podcasts only.
Oh, no, that's all good.
Just right in the middle of our
he's
video.
Trying to get an underwear deal.
he's wearing Mac Weldon, so that's pretty good.
He is wearing Mac Weldon's.
I mean, no one.
Everyday wear.
How does he look in real life? I'll be honest.
No one. I mean, Dante Washington's the only one that can compete with something so beautiful.
You could bounce a header against Mexico off of it. I mean, it is beautiful.
Perfect segue.
Second time they've interrupted. He's interrupted.
Second
a video.
Time. It's
first
on
time
purpose.
He took his shirt off. So thank God he didn't double up. So, what do you think the goal of golfer is? It's you're not going to convert every basketball court in America. How do you begin this process?
Well, first off. Don't tell me I'm not going to do that.
Oh, God. Yeah.
No.
Go
your
fight you.
Listening when I go, damn it.
She's like,
I'm never going to have him.
Yeah. I'm never going to drive a Phantom. So here is the success. The success is in shifting a paradigm to help people understand the basketball court you see, the tennis court you see, the blacktop you see that's dormant, that's not being used, that's inactive. We can activate it, and it takes innovation to bring it to life for someone else.
Right.
And I'll say this: follow the skateboard crowd. If you ever want to see how you turn anything into what you want,
100%.
They've been doing it for years, right? So it's funny. I kind of like it's like when like rats leave a ship and you know it's sinking. You know, not to call skateboarders rats. I love you guys, but like they're predictive and prescient and they know the space to get to.
Yeah.
And they they get this bad rap, but they turn something that wasn't being used into something beautiful that people love to watch and people love to do. So Golfer is going to convert basketball courts, tennis courts, handball courts, blacktops into multi-sport surfaces so that kids get to decide what they're going to play on the day. You don't tell them what they're going to play. Right. And by the way, the basketball community we have is beautiful. I love basketball. One of my closest friends has become Steve Nash because I dream of being a basketball player and always wanted to, and he always wanted to be a soccer player. And we have this like fun, man, I wish I was you. And
well, now you should start calling the NBA Finals because he gets to call the Champions League. Right?
Who is he? I'm pitching for that.
To call the Champions.
I mean, Adam Silver hooked me up.
Yeah.
So what I want to do is say this. I want to push back on a few ideas. One, that the game has to be played on this beautiful grass or turf field in this huge space. They're limited. They're difficult to get to. And typically, there's a large cost associated with.
Of course. How to push, keep up that grass is
I
insane.
I want to push back against that. I also want to push back against this idea that you need to specialize in a sport at a young age. No, you don't. Don't do it. Kids play as many sports as you can for as long as you possibly can.
Right.
Steve didn't start playing basketball until he was 13, two-time NBA MVP. So what
Wait,
I want
I
Golfer to do...
I started playing basketball before him, and he was an MVP.
I mean, you still have a chance. Man.
Yeah, anything's possible.
That's the moral of the story. Yeah. Keep going.
So I couldn't even dunk on the goal you're going to put below the basketball
rim. So is there an agenda? Yeah, my agenda is the greatest sport on the planet. I know through just attrition and inertia is going to continue to grow here, but I'm going to plant all these little seeds that activates the communities that are full of kids that need the power of sport, full of kids that are going to be incredible players, full of kids that just deserve to find something that's so loving and so accepting and decide what they want to play on the day and play multiple sports. And we could do it tomorrow. We just need people to start saying, yeah. So Golfer was the, okay, it's not an abstract idea anymore. Give me a yes and I'll give you a goal.
Okay.
I mean, shouldn't it just be Golfer Street FC?
So you know,
they kind of seem like they overlap.
So they overlap, and in the kind of Venn diagram of this business plan, these are two separate businesses that benefit from one another. Both of them are moving people towards this idea of you don't need, not exclusively, because this isn't anti-coaching, this isn't anti-competitive sports, this isn't anti-soccer fields with grass or turf.
Yeah, this is extracurricular.
Yeah, this is you should be doing this all the time to supplement all of that other stuff. And by the way, maybe it's the only stuff you're doing if you're not one of the talented few or the arbitrarily chosen few that get to go up the pyramid. So this should be the world that you participate in recreational, fun, inclusive, easy, cheap pickup soccer.
And this is something that can change a little bit, like the identity of a community, just by having the option
100%
of it being there. The kids themselves can grow up in. You can meet new friends. You can like-minded individuals.
Totally.
It can do a. It's more than just soccer, why it's great.
I grew up in tough streets of Westport, Connecticut. I mean, I was in a very sheltered world growing up, and we came from an Italian-American, blue-collar immigrant background that my dad was the first to become successful. And my life was going from living in a room with all my brothers at a terrible house to like, oh my God, this house is huge.
Yeah.
And I lost the real world at some point because I didn't have access to perspective.
Okay.
And so the world's getting scary because people are upset with people they've never met and they don't understand and they don't take the time to appreciate. Soccer introduced me to a Caribbean culture, a Latino culture, and honestly changed the way I see the world in a way that's made me such a better person, and I'm so grateful for that. So this isn't only about let's get inner city kids and low income people playing.
Let's get everybody.
That's huge. Yeah, that's huge, and I care about that so much, and I'm passionate about it because they're being discriminated against. But we need the wealthy and closed off to be educated and interact and use a conduit like sport, which is kind of the last bastion of people with diametrically opposed positions sitting next to them.
So that they can become better dancers by meeting all these Latino
people.
People.
Loosen up these rich white people's hips.
Exactly.
Okay, get out there, Samba.
By the way, CEOs and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and senators, everything is looking different.
Yeah.
The world is moving, and it's, you know, was it Martin Luther King that said the arc of you know, justice is long, or the arc of history is long, but it bends towards justice. We're getting there, and we're facing some pretty ugly things to get there. Sport is the most powerful vehicle. So Street FC and Golfer are using profit motive and bringing people that want to make money. And listen, there's nothing wrong with capitalism if you can take that innovation open things up
for good,
and reinvest things back into communities and have substantive leave behinds.
Well, here's the thing I think that's important is when we started this podcast, we said there wasn't people who sounded like us. No one was talking the way we talk, and no one talked to us when we were kids about soccer, because everything that was more for a different crowd, I'll say. Street FC, it's right in the name, Street. I mean, if I had a place to go and play that wasn't, I had one park where I could play, and it was like adult Central American dudes that were playing. There was no Cubans there. They showed me how to play a little bit, enough for me to get on a team. And it was like they took me under their wing. But these were adults. If there was a place for us kids to pick a basketball court and kick the ball around and play with my friends, I would have been able to learn at my own pace.
Totally. You know? And here's the most important part of that, and I agree with all that. It was really well said, is I got asked in my playing career. I was a specific type of player that was kind of unique. I had this kind of this flair that was in Congress with, you know, white kid from Westport, Connecticut.
And like Jack Wilshere. English, but he played like a Spaniard. You were like this white guy, but you had this flair.
I played like a Jamaican. Yeah.
You had this flair, and I was like, the reason why,
and I would say, like, I give all my creativity and all my development, all of that credit, for the most part, goes to the Caribbean guys that allowed a skinny white kid from Westport to come into that gym. Edson Buttle brought me one day, and his dad, Winston, said, go for it. And the Latino guys in Bridgeport, Connecticut, when you go into that gym, and it costs next to nothing to go into it, it was and Sir Matt Busby, the great Manchester United coach, has a saying, if you're good enough, you're old enough. It was a, come in, the only thing we care about is can you actually come out here and play? And I learned so much. And, like, those gyms exist in a competitive sense, and they exist in no one can kick and trap a ball.
Yeah.
And that's the beauty of this game is it doesn't matter. You don't have to qualify for it.
Right.
And you should never have to qualify for it. So Street FC brings it to everyone.
And I've guarded Carl Martino on the pitch, and I'm like, this guy got some sauce. All right? Yeah. This guy can move.
Every time he runs past me, I hear a steel drum.
What would my N1 name be?
Your N1?
Yeah. Ooh.
Ooh, right? You can't be the professor or something like that.
What about Silky Burns?
Nah, yo.
Like Mr. Burns, like body type, but Silky.
Nah, you'd be like, you'd be Beef Patty.
yo, Beef Patty.
Beef sauce. Yeah.
Well, beans and rice.
Kyle, this,
tweet at us. Tweet at us. What should my N1?
What's your Street FC nickname?
My Street FC
N1 Everybody gets a nickname. What?
Okay, so.
Mine's heart disease.
Real quick.
Best one gets a t-shirt.
Your campaign was the first time I think we both paid attention to the process itself of how U.S.
Say
soccer.
It the way we wanted. We gave a shit about who the president was.
Yeah. And so many people did for the first time, which
was
awesome.
Yeah. So my curiosity really wants to know just from you, what was the thing that you felt the most, like, what walls were there that prevented you from outside of just getting the votes? Because it seemed like when the votes came in, we didn't understand, like, well, based on the optimism of the Martino platform, it seems like more people should have been interested in some change and some progress. But it seems like American soccer, U.S. soccer, that's not really the motive to change.
Let me I may have said this, but I don't think in an interview yet. So let me give you the breaking soundbite. I knew the night before the election I lost.
Whoa.
Because I knew the athletes were blocking for Carlos Cordero. And here's the problem. Blaming the athletes is a shortcut to thinking. Was I heartbroken and did I feel betrayed? Of course. But this idea that they're on the take and it's this whole inside conspiracy thing is so far from the truth. And so many of them take time out of their professional careers, fly all over the place to try to fix and help govern the game. So I push back against that. And there are a few of them that acted in personal interest against me and against what's good for the game. And we won't have relationships again. And that's sad. But I made an assumption that I was going to get their support because I was an athlete, and that's my fault. So I finally was able to have the humility to say, them not voting for me was not, they made a terrible choice. Like, you know, I can't believe they would do that. That's so stupid. Some of it was my bad because I made an assumption that I didn't take the time to go to the most important group to help them see. So
before you continue, why do you think you weren't chosen by the players? Not specifically what did someone else do. Is there anything from your campaign that you thought struck a chord with them that they were
couldn't vote for you.
I think, listen, I had outside of Carlos the most support from them. But once they block, it doesn't matter.
Right.
Because it was never going to be an individual thing. The reason they didn't vote for me, and I can see it now, and I think if I was in their shoes, I probably would have felt the same way, is the lack of experience is a leap of faith. So someone who has someone who didn't graduate from college, who sits on TV and talks sometimes not even cogently or coherently about the game, putting that person in charge of an organization of that size with a $300 million budget is a massive leap of faith. So that one I understand, I accept. And here's the thing, that they knew Carlos, and a lot of them had worked with him. And Carlos is a good guy. And Carlos, if you sit and have coffee with him and talk with him, he's very, very smart. He's a compassionate person. He had a lot of support within that group because they'd spent a lot of time with him. So I think their bleep felt better with him to say he's going to be different than what came before. And the disappointment of him not getting things done on the inside before, we're going to give him a pass and we're going to give him an opportunity to succeed. So I still give him that. That I still hope. I mean, I think it's ridiculous to root against them. I still hope the athletes are right. I really do. And at this point, the most important thing about the election is they're activated, fans are activated. We have elections that will always be challenged from here on out.
Everybody's paying attention.
The biggest thing that's broken that upset me throughout the whole thing was knowing that I was going to lose the night before was based on a system that is incredibly insular and the patronage that makes it easy to do that calculus the night before and know it's over is based on such a small group of people that are not representative of the membership having such a weighted vote and influence on what should be a democratic process.
Yeah, it's really hard even we were paying attention and it was very difficult during the, there he is, shirts off at some point, Jimmy Conrad.
Unbelievable.
I mean, it's just. Sparse chest hair in 2000.
By the way, every time it's a serious conversation for having that. Last time we were talking about how there's not enough black people in the game and he walks by with a shirt.
I will say, one of the most remarkable.
Forward Madison, everybody.
Yeah. One of the most remarkable things Jimmy Conrad can pull off is he can make having no pecs still look manly. It looked manly, didn't it? Yeah. He looked.
Can I tell you something? Having no pecs is better than having boobs. So sorry, everybody. That's why I don't take my shirt off.
Out of your way.
Yeah. No, please.
No, take your time, Jimmy. We're not doing it.
How much heat? Be honest. You don't have to name names, but how much heat did you take when you came out with the ProRel 2030 thing?
A ton of heat, and I got an incredible amount of internal pressure.
Did you get a couple of texts from friends like, yo, what the fuck?
Yeah. It was the political third rail. And listen, anything I said during the election, which this might be one of the reasons I lost, I'm not a good politician. So I would say something when I believed it, and that's not a really good political strategy, right? So when you're
unless it's like insane and about a wall.
Yeah. The only wall
you should have
I'd
Russia
be building is a five-man wall.
But why didn't you have Russia help you with the election?
No. Well, next time.
Next one.
Zuckerberg, I'll call you. Yeah. So here's the thing that about that was actually interesting about that. The ProRel people, I believe in what they're doing, and some of them are incredible, and they fought such an amazing fight, and they're out there all day trying to get what we should have, a sporting meritocracy that opens up the game for everyone. It's a proven system that even though we're a different culture, will work, I promise you. It can't be switched on overnight.
Right.
But the problem is they've become so vitriolic and so tribal that they are eating their own.
Yes.
So I came out, which didn't help me politically at all, and said I'm for promotion relegation. And the biggest attacks I took was from the ProRel crowd.
Of course, because you didn't say tomorrow.
Yeah.
You said 23rd.
Here's like where these guys, it's just I can't with them. Some of them are celebrities based off of it. And I promise you, because I've talked to them personally, I don't think they genuinely want it to happen because overnight they become irrelevant.
They lose their
100%.
So, I asked some of them, okay, I believe in it. What's your plan? Crickets. They don't have plans. They have
they pontificate.
Torches.
That's it. Yeah.
Right? And so you are never going to, and you will never get promotion relegation with a sledgehammer. It has to be a scalpel that you really come up with a very fine line and a plan. I was the only one that actually put a plan forward on how to pull it off.
Yeah.
And got crushed by promotion relegation people about how long it's going to take.
On
and,
both sides. You got crushed on both sides.
There was no win for me about saying that.
Yeah.
And why I said it was because I believe it, not to get some political win. So we need it. It's so important.
You think it'll ever happen?
It absolutely will happen because... It is happening. The mousetrap outside of a model, and I love MLS, and I'm not going to sit here and bash. Listen, Don and I butted heads several times during the election. There are things I disagree wholeheartedly, and we're diametrically opposed in a lot of things. And there are a lot of things he's done a great job in growing the brand. So calling him a victim or calling him a villain and saying he's a part
it's
of a
just
mafia.
Not true.
It's just not only is it not true, it's not helpful.
No.
So MLS has a great model that unfortunately it can't last because it's predicated on this notion that you always have someone new coming in willing to buy in. And it's not really revenue. You know, a franchise fee is not revenue. You share revenue, so you're basically allowing someone to come in and profit share and give you money so you're not diluted, right? So ultimately, how you improve the game, affinity is grown locally. Now, the Atlanta thing's amazing, and it's beautiful, and it's based off of an amazing MLS owner and so many things that we can break down. But affinity is grown locally. So if we think long-term MLS is going to compete with the Premier League, with La Liga, with Bundesliga, when they have wage bills where Stoke City's wage bill 2 seasons ago when they got relegated was more than the entire MLS, you're not overnight going to close that quality gap. So where you do it is by people feeling they belong and they own it and it's down the street and it's theirs. MLS can't grow into every market. So you have to use that incredible platform pyramid trickle down, which works in the sports world when it's done based off of rewarding teams that perform. And it's one of the reasons I bought into promotion relegation with Mallorca as an owner. We got relegated in our first season. We were in Segunda B, which, by the way, there's 80 teams. I mean, getting out of that, it's a quagmire.
Yeah.
But it's the most beautiful and special moment to see a club that has fans that love it regardless of what league they're in and support it and dream one day. Forget winning a title like Leicester. Dream one day they'll be back in the big time.
Yeah.
That, the power of that and how that improves every single game, the quality you see on the TV, the development, it is an incredible tool not being utilized. And if I went into MLS owners and I got a chance to pitch it to them, no one's going in and pitching it to them. People are only pitching why it's a terrible idea to them. I promise you enough owners now get it and want it, and they're not the majority yet, get it and want it enough to start conversations to come up with a plan.
Here's my thing. We had someone on this podcast. We did an interview while we were here who was like, wait. I don't understand these new fans from the last 5 years. If Premier League started tomorrow, there would be no promotion or relegation. Very different. I mean, this is a very old school guy, and we're sitting here thinking like, well, we're talking to the guy or one of the guys that when the fans are like, it'll never change because of the people at the top. This is one of those dudes. You know what I mean?
Who are we talking?
Kevin Payne.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And so listen, I like Kevin. Kevin's another one. I've got a long relationship. I've known Kevin for a while. We got in screaming fights just like Don and I did during the election. But both of them have done really, really good
things
for soccer.
Yeah.
And so we talk about it. How do you honor that?
How do you honor that but also be like, yo, I think we could take the ball from here and carry a little further.
Like,
how do you do that?
It's tough. That's politics, right? So one day Don's not going to be the commissioner of Major League Soccer anymore. And when he leaves, I hope people can, just like with Sunil, you can be upset. You can say you made this mistake, you made that mistake, you should have done this. But to say that you didn't do good things for the game is wrong and I think unfair. And it makes it harder for us to have discourse with the power brokers, because when you scream at them and you call anyone a villain and you create a conspiracy theory in a van that drives by to show that people are crooks, no one's gonna sit and listen to you.
I forgot about, did they do that this year?
I don't know.
Last year.
The beauty of this convention is I don't care. I've had really good discussions
with
Don.
You're like, put a goal in the van. I don't care what's in there.
I've had really good discussions with Don. I've had really good discussions with Kevin, where ultimately we've agreed to disagree, but we've done it in a way where we can start that conversation again. You know, and that's what has to happen. We need to have someone in the rebel crowd, if you want to call it, that understands you need to broker this. You're not going to storm the gates. It's not happening.
Yeah.
Yeah. And at the very least, I think your campaign, I think when we look back and it, say ProRel does happen or there are major changes in American soccer, I think people will look back at your campaign and say, like, hey, this was a pivotal moment in some sort of change and pushing for some progress in a way that makes some sense. Because it was the first time I read your platform. I read everything you put out, and I'm like, okay, I couldn't believe I was
astounded. I spent, and thank you so much to all the fans that supported through Kickstarter or whatever. I spent a ton of money to get some incredible minds together for a 2-day summit in New York to put together that progress plan, and didn't think for a second it was a competitive advantage. I just assumed, of course, everyone's going to say how they're going to do this, right?
Yeah.
You're not just going to stand there and say, I'm going to get women equal pay, and I'm going to, you know, no one's going to pay to play the game, and we're going to win the World Cup. Yeah, it's like, yeah, love it. How?
Yeah.
So the fact that, like, no one stepped up to really put together anything substantive that now we could say, remember you promised this, remember you said you'd do this,
yeah,
remember that I did that in 2 years, if I didn't do this stuff,
yeah,
come to the soccer house. And literally, like, drag me out.
You mean that castle that they're standing at?
Demoted soccer house.
But listen, that was not me. I'm loud. I'm passionate. I'm creative. I can bring people together. That was everyone else. Listen, just like Don's not the one keeping promotion relegation from happening, no one person is going to switch it on.
Yeah.
So we can't live in this world where, like, man, like, you know, we gotta find Neo. Like, where is he? Like, you know, if we find him,
there's no golden bullet. There's no needle in the haystack.
Last thing before we let you go, you had one of the greatest Instagram months in history of Instagram. Your quest to be verified on Instagram was one of the most entertaining things.
Give me a comedic critique. I do. Incredible.
Crushing it.
So much that we were angry.
Dude.
Get out of our business, man.
I was like, wow, I'm glad he lost that election, man.
Wait, the worst part about it was, and I'll tell you how it started. I'd been off of Instagram for a long time, and I got back on, and while I was gone, you had this verified, like, you could apply to get verified. And so someone said, oh, yeah, just you apply. And when you apply, you have to send them a picture of your license, which, like, I mean, I'm not, like, a tinfoil hat guy, but I'm like, am I really sending my license to these people?
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, I'll do it. Like, I'll acquiesce, so I'll go for it. And then I got denied. And I was like, what? When you do the pity date and get stood up. I'm like, you gotta be kidding me.
So we keep getting denied.
The first one, I, like, didn't even think about doing it, but the first one, I was walking into my dressing room, and I saw my name, and I was like, let me do this. This will be funny. But then I started to think how often during the day you have to verify yourself and say, you know, no, that's me. Yeah, Kyle. And so I just was, like, coming up with all these ridiculous ways.
The one where you were, like, at dinner with your wife, and you're like, oh, look, who's here? My wife.
And it was always verified. Someone that was verified, too.
I was so jealous. I'm like, insecure. That's what we should have done.
I am insecure, but now I've got no material. Yeah. My Instagram sucks now.
Yeah, comedy's hard. Comedy's hard, Kyle.
Yeah. It's not just the first five, buddy. It's not just your first album. You got to write a second one. Yeah, not at all.
Well, congratulations.
It was amazing.
Yeah, it was a good pilot. Developed a lot of characters. I got one more question, though. Who's the best Robbie out of the two?
Oh, come on. What are you going to ask next? Which is my favorite kid?
You know you got one because that name just popped in your head, and I'm not asking.
For me, there's only one Robbie, and that's not an individual one. I think of it as there's only one Robbie.
Oh, the two of them are one Robbie?
Robbie.
Yeah.
All right. He really is a politician. No, don't listen to what he says.
It's Robbie Earl.
I know it. He's our favorite, too.
Kyle Martino, thank you so much for taking some time with us. Make everyone make sure to follow Kyle Martino.
Hold on. Where did they get the three things?
Oh, wait, that was last year.
Yeah.
The three things. Street FC, Gopher, and Street.
Well, here's the last thing. The call to action is go. Eventually here soon, Gopher, the presentation is going to be out on the web. Go tell a story. Like, get people excited. Get principals of schools, Parks and Rec people, your friend, your neighbor, the postman. Get everyone excited about that. Street FC is coming soon, so follow at the Street FC because we got games coming for everyone. And then Street Soccer USA, go to the website, streetsoccerusa.org, and donate, help, volunteer. All amazing.
And things. I'm sure you'll hear all about it on your Instagram, which is at...
Verified. at Kyle Martino. It's funny, that's my name.
Yeah.
I just had to go with that.
Should have been verified. Thank you so much for being here.
Kyle, cheers, man.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Yeah, baby, we're back.
Yes, wasn't that great, Kyle Martino? I you know, I gotta say, I've actually grown very fond of Kyle Martino.
Yeah, me too. You know, when he was first running, we were all very suspicious as to his ideas, and then as the plans started to come out and he started to do more, we're like, yo, this guy's like really putting in the work.
Yeah.
And
genuine guy,
very genuine. You know, he doesn't hide who he is. He doesn't. There's no falsehoods. He's like, look, here's what I am. Here's what I want to do. Here's what I think I could do. And I truly believed he thought he could win. I honestly believed it. He could win. And then it was kind of like soul crushing to find out that he knew the night before. It's just like, ah.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even have shown up. I would have shown up. I would have just been mushing people in the face.
But I think that the interesting takeaway from that interview where he mentioned that he did lose friends because of that campaign. And I'm like curious to who.
Oh,
right?
I think we know.
I think we do know. But yeah. I don't want to speculate. But it's interesting. There's a lot of drama going on. U.S. soccer is more than just kicking the ball around and
Dome's right.
And playing U.S. soccer men's national team games in front of 40 people. that all paid $700.
That Berhalter is off to a good start. You know, right now U.S. soccer is like, why don't we just make each ticket really expensive so that when only a few people show up, we still make the money we're supposed to.
Really. So it's interesting.
Kyle, he gave us all real conversation. You know what I mean? And that's what I like about him. And that's why we're happy to have him on. And, it's a real shame you didn't win, bud. But it is what it is. You've been on our show, so it's kind of like you won.
Exactly. You won our hearts.
Yeah.
So let us know what you thought of the Kyle Martino interview, if there was anything that stuck out to you. We all take different things from the interview. You know, that was the thing that stood out to me. Maybe it's something different for you. Just like the way people listen to the Kevin Payne. I love that. People were like finding different things. They were like,
a lot of people agreed, too.
A lot of people agreed. A lot of people hated him, but they hated him for different reasons, which is great.
Yeah. That's what we want for our guests, is for you guys to hate them all for different reasons.
Okay, it shows the diversity of hatred.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, our Cooligans fans aren't a one thought.
Okay, it's not groupthink.
Yeah, no, not at all.
All right, you better be unique in your hatred.
Oh, the vitriol is different from every angle.
So, thank you again for listening to that interview. Thanks for listening to the show. We always appreciate it. I can't stress the next couple months. I'm excited about this MLS season. The Cooligans 2019 season is going to be absolutely sick, man.
Epic, dude.
A lot of fun. It's condensed like the MLS season.
Single podcast elimination.
So, and just a reminder, Daryl Grove of Total Soccer Show, his GoFundMe is just right under the goal of $100,000. So
yeah, help him get to that. That would be great.
So we still have it as our Instagram link. Because
we're Team Daryl forever.
That's right. So just go to our Instagram page and click on the link and feel free to donate. It's very, very close to $100,000.
And if you can't donate, just share it.
Exactly. So just an update on Daryl. Daryl did, if you don't know, he did have...
Are we supposed to say?
Yeah, he had his surgery.
He successfully had surgery.
Yeah, and he's recovering. He's getting better. And he has to next up his chemo and things like that. So, but we're happy to know that the surgery went well. And we're just optimistic.
He's a tough son of a bitch. He's going to be here for a while. Yeah. That's what I'm happy about.
Yeah. It's weird to call somebody who has cancer a son of a bitch.
But I said he's a tough son of a bitch. So, like, that's a good thing.
So it's good. Okay, cool. Yeah. That's how Alexis shows love.
I'm not going to say something nice. Yeah. What am I? I'm not a weak son of a bitch. No, he's a tough dude. And we're very happy to have him be a friend of ours and a colleague of ours in this podcasting community. And also, if you live in the New England area, we will be at Rhode Island Country Club. March.
Rhode Island Country Club.
Oh, we're bringing our monocles. We're going to look like that emoji. Like, excuse me? Are you serving me frozen chicken? Well, I don't think so. But we're going to be there March 29th.
March 29th. Project Goal. It is a fundraiser that's open to the public. You can go to projectgoal.org to get tickets. And
they get kids from the hood more involved in soccer, and their education is a big part of it as well. So, I mean, those are two things that Christian and I are very, very passionate about. So we're more than happy to be out there. If you want to come hang out with us, get a ticket to the Project Goal. You know the money's going to a good, occasion. What is it?
A good cause.
A good cause, I think, is the word I should have used there. It's definitely going to be a good occasion, but it's going to go to a good cause. Come hang out. There's going to be some big names from New England Revolution, present and past.
Okay.
It's going to be dope.
I heard president passed.
Well, present and past.
There you
At
go.
Least past, we know that for sure. Maybe not present, but we, you know, who knows?
Okay. So all right. So that's it. That's the end of the show. Thank you again for listening. Hope you had a good time. Hope you laughed a whole bunch.
Yeah.
Because that's all. We talk over each other and we laugh a lot.
Yeah. So I hope you didn't also hate this. I like to think that she listens to every episode and she's like, another terrible episode. They talked over each other.
So thank you again for listening. My name is Christian Polanco.
My name is Alexis Guerrero.
And together, what are we?
The Cooligans!